Good morning.
Good morning.
Surprise! When Pastor went on vacation, can you believe I had another vacation with Pastor? You're going to be stuck with me. I don't have anything special. Anybody have any good announcements today other than what's in the bulletin? Other than it's a beautiful day. We're going to be looking at the gospel lesson for the message. Other than that, let's begin our worship. We begin with our opening hymn. Please stand.
This is the ninth Sunday after Pentecost. Our Old Testament reading is in Genesis. It's after the family and all the animals had come out of the ark. They also built an altar and worshiped the Lord. And then now this is the beginning of the rainbow. God said to Noah and to his sons with him, "Behold, I establish my covenant with you and your offspring after you, and with every living creature that is with you, the birds, the livestock, and every beast of the earth with you, as many as came out of the ark. It is for every beast of the earth. I establish my covenant with you, that never again shall all flesh be cut off by the waters of the flood, and never again shall there be a flood to destroy the earth." And God said, "The sign of the covenant that I made between me and you and every living creature that is with you for all future generations, I have set my vow in the cloud, and it shall be a sign of the covenant between me and the earth. When I bring clouds over the earth and the vow is seen in the clouds, I will remember my covenant that is between me and you and every living creature of all flesh. And the water shall never again become a flood to destroy all flesh. When the bow is in the clouds, I will see it and remember the everlasting covenant between God and every living creature of all flesh that is on the earth." God said to Noah, "This is the sign of the covenant that I will establish between me and all flesh that is on the earth." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Continue with the gradual middle of page 3. O the depths of the riches of wisdom and knowledge of God.
How unsearchable are his judgments and how unsearchable his ways.
For from him and through him and to him are all things.
To him be glory
forever. Amen. The epistle reading is written by St. Paul, and it is written to the Methodist Church. For this reason, I bow my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named, that according to the riches of his glory, he may grant you to be strengthened with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may have strength to comprehend all the saints, what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ that it surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly in all that we ask or think, according to the power at work within us, to him be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus through all generations, forever and ever. Amen. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. We stand for the Alleluia verse of the reading of the Holy Gospel. Take heart, it is I. Do not
be afraid. And he got into the boat with them, and the wind ceased, and they were utterly astounded, for they did not understand about the loaves, but their hearts were hardened. When they had crossed over, they came to land in Gennesaret, and they moored on the shore. And when they got out of the boat, the people immediately recognized him, and ran about the whole region, and began to bring the sick people on their beds to whatever they had heard he was, wherever they heard he was. And whatever he came, the villages, the cities, the countryside, they laid the sick in the marketplace and implored him that they might touch even the fringe of his garment. And as many as touched it were made well. This is the gospel of the Lord.
We
a similar gospel reading. You remember? Jesus had just fed the 5,000. And then they got the boat across the Sea of Galilee. The Sea of Galilee. What do we know about it? What do you know about the Sea of Galilee? It's a freshwater lake. Although, it's almost 700 feet below sea level. Now you say, well, that's not unusual. Salt Lake, our lake like this is about 4,200 feet above sea level, the Great Salt Lake. And in terms of size, the Sea of Galilee is about 64 square miles. Well, I was looking around trying to find something that was close to that, and close to that would be Chicago Lake. That's somewhere around 53 square miles. So, you know, the Chicago's got all these arms and legs, whatever you want to call them, inlets, whereas the Sea of Galilee is more of a whole thing. The Sea of Galilee, not really a big sea, as we think of the oceans, sort of a lake. Water comes in from the Jordan River from the north, springs feed it, it goes out to the south, and stops at the Dead Sea, the saltwater sea. The saltwater sea there is a lot bigger and a lot lower. The Sea of Galilee, where preaching and teaching takes place both on the hills that surround it, and in the boat, not only today, but when he was also preaching in the boat to people who gathered on the shore, getting pushed out. The Sea of Galilee comes up many, many times. So we should know a little bit about that lake, that sea. And it's situated, like I say, below sea level, with mountains around the sides of it, especially towards the west, which makes it possible for the winds to come rushing between the hills. If you've ever been south of Buffalo and the hills out there and you're down the valley, sometimes you get some rushing winds through there. But the winds sort of channel through the hills, come right down because they're coming down the lake because it's so much lower. And they hit the water and they can cause storms. Tremendous storms that you don't see coming. Although, in our gospel lesson today, it doesn't say a storm, it says a strong wind. Well, it was one of those winds coming off the lake, the Mediterranean Sea, coming down through the mountains, down the hills, across the lake. And here Jesus had sent them to go to the other side, to go up to the northeast corner, while he was dismissing the crowd and again praying by himself. That sudden windstorm made it hard for these seasoned sailors, if you will, fishermen, to get across. At that time, what did you have? You had oars, maybe one sail. If you're going in, the wind's coming against you, you're not going to use a sail, you're going to have to go the other direction. So you're having to try to row your way across there. And after they've been gone for a while, in the middle of the night, at the end of the day, Jesus can still see them. Well, you can see across the lake. You can still see them out there just struggling. The winds blow, the night comes. And these fishermen didn't like. They would not be out fishing in this kind of weather. They would not be on the lake in this kind of weather. Because the boats weren't that safe. They didn't have life jackets. And who's going to come and get them? They didn't have any rescue people at that time. You had to rescue yourself. Yet here they were in the middle of the lake trying.
Why would they cry out? If they recognized him, they'd say, help, wouldn't they? But they cried out because they thought it was a ghost. Now again, if you know a little bit about the time of Jesus and look a bit at the folklore and the things that were distressing people at the time, it was a common thread sown between fishermen and people that were on lakes or seas. That night was not a good time to be out there because that's when the spirits would make those harsh winds. And if you ever saw a ghost, you were doomed. You were doomed! That trip that you're making or wherever you're going would probably end in catastrophe. So they were scared. They thought it was a ghost. They thought it was going to be calamity coming in a direction. Instead, it was Jesus. And you'd say, well, they should remember. They should remember when he was asleep in the stern of the boat, and they woke him up because he was in another storm at that time in the Sea of Galilee. They should have remembered and remembered what he did when he fed the 5,000. They should remember and recognize Jesus right away for his power and might, but the gospel says they didn't. For they did not understand about the loaves. They didn't understand how it was when Jesus stepped in the boat. The winds calm. It says their hearts were hard. Where have you heard those words before? Never, or hardly ever, about the disciples. You hear about their hearts being hard. You hear about the Pharisees, Sadducees, preachers of the law, the rulers hardening their hearts against Jesus and his message, but not the disciples, not those 12 men who followed Jesus, who were learning at his feet. Their hearts were hardened. They couldn't understand all that was going on. Even though they had seen, heard, felt, touched even, Jesus' miracles, they couldn't understand how it was that this was going on. And maybe they started saying to themselves, it's too good to be true. Maybe we shouldn't have done what we've done following him. We've wasted 2 years. Maybe we should go back, go fishing at the last season. We're not out in the middle of the boat, in the middle of the storm, in the middle of the night. We don't have to face all the problems that are there in front of us right now. We can go back and live a safe life. And their hearts were hardened. Not so hardened that they didn't keep following Jesus, though. But they couldn't grasp the greatness of Jesus, the power that Jesus had. And it was by his word that things were done. Healing. Raising the dead. Calming storms. They might not have understood. But in our gospel lesson today, we're told that people understood that Jesus was good. Jesus was somebody special. Because it says, as soon as they heard that he had crossed in the boat to the other side, they ran to find him. And they brought all who were sick, dragging them on the beds, on makeshift cots, on whatever, so they could just touch his robe. The people, at least, had a feeling for Jesus. And they were ready and willing to welcome them into their midst because of what they saw him giving to them. They say, yes, if God being somebody like in the Old Testament times, when Moses put up the snake, when he looked at the snake, you no longer were going to die from the poison that he gives you. You know, that was a gift. God, we can accept that. Anything that makes us better. But that's only touching the surface of what Jesus was trying to tell and teach, not only the people, but the disciples and you and I. The words of Jesus, his disciples, take heart in his eye, do not be afraid. What's the common fears about him being a ghost? But it also should bring our minds back to many, many times when those words, especially, do not be afraid, or peace be with you. We can start with the angels in the Judean countryside and speaking to shepherds. Maybe before that, to Mary, to Joseph, to Zechariah, to anyone you want, where God speaks to them. Always it's got to be peace to you. Blessed are you. My presence is here. They couldn't understand God at work. So their hearts were hardened. So they couldn't look forward. And you know, they carried on throughout Jesus' ministry. How many of the disciples followed Jesus to the cross? The other ones went away. Their hearts were not focused on Jesus being Savior, but on being a kind of ruler, and they couldn't accept the fact that this was happening. So they just left. They were weak. We all are weak. But Jesus says, "You're not. Don't be afraid. I'm with you." They say, "Okay, we know that. We know everything you said." Maybe except a little bit about like skip the album. Go back to the Old Testament reading for today. God and Noah. You know, what kind of faith did it take for Noah? Spend years building an ark. Then loading an ark. And then floating around for 40 days. Until it got dry. And then coming out. How much faith did that take? What would you have said if you were Noah? Thank goodness I built this ark. I'm not getting wet at least. And God said, it's more than you're not getting wet. Look, I'm making a promise. You heard, Noah heard God speaking, or did what God asked, was rewarded with life and promise. We hear God's word. When we do God's word, when we are his people, when we are not afraid of being his people, when we tell others the love of Christ shown in our lives, do what we can for them, we are rewarded. But not with something from this world. As long as we love and believe in Jesus, we have life. True life. So how do we put this all together? How do we make good on the gospel lesson today, the other readings, in our life? How many of you are familiar with Rembrandt's painting of the storm and Jesus in the boat? Now, it's not quite what we're talking about, they walking on the water. And there are some of them. In fact, my parents' church in Buckley, Illinois, on this side, they got a big area, they got a big picture. And it's Jesus walking on the water towards the boat. A Rembrandt's painting from 1630, which was stolen in 1990, has never been found. He had captured the storm and the waves and the boat and the disciples being afraid, and it's theory.
trust in Jesus for our life? I don't know, so Father, praise. In fact, we're here because we celebrate that. We celebrate that we're one with Him. He with us in our communion, in our worship, in our lives. Walking on the lake is something that we can't do nowadays. You can put those little pontoons on here and ride a bike. You can walk on water. Jesus didn't have those conveniences. He did it because of the power that was His. The ability, not only over nature, but over sin and death and the devil. I pray that He would give you that kind of power in our life as we go on from this day. Amen. And the peace and love which comes from God our Father, Jesus Christ, guide and direct your hearts and minds, both now and forever. Amen. We continue our worship with the Apostles' Creed. We're on the bottom of page 4, we stand. I am indeed God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We remain standing for the prayer of the church. Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus, and for all people according to their needs. Eternal Father, our God and Creator and Redeemer, we thank You that You've drawn us to Yourself by the power of Your Word and to our Savior, Jesus Christ, our Lord. For Your promises of life and salvation, we give You praise and adoration as our God and Lord. Keep us in steady faith in You. Guide our steps in the ways of Your life-giving Word. And make us to be ever more
He gave it to them, saying, drink all of this cup is a new testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This new